Hey there, welcome to Seeker Plus, where we take in-depth looks at topics over the course of three episodes. I'm your host, Julian Huguet, and for this series, we're going to talk about what's been called the single most complex construction project in the history of humanity. A structure nearly as big as an American football field with a price tag in the hundreds of billions of dollars, and yet, at its most full, it's only ever housed 13 people. I bet the space nerds have already figured it out, and I mean anybody who looked at the title of the series for that matter. That's right, our topic is the International Space Station, better known as the ISS. And who better to tell us about it than two people actually living aboard the station itself? Hello guys, can you hear me?
We have you loud and clear. Welcome aboard.
Welcome aboard. Ooh, that gave me chills. That's NASA astronaut Shane Kimbrough and ESA astronaut Thomas Pesquet, and they really are no fooling up in space. Look, I'll prove it. Hey, can one of you guys do a backflip or something?
We can do a couple things for you.
See, like I said, space. Well, unless you're listening to the podcast version of this episode, in which case, you're just going to have to take my word for it. We connected with them while they were off the west coast of Morocco. Now, as the crow flies, it's not the longest distance phone call I've made. At least not yet. NASA graciously let us borrow these important spacefarers for 20 minutes, so we'll see where they are by the end of it. Keep in mind that in order to keep the ISS's average altitude at about 420 kilometers above the Earth instead of, you know, 0 kilometers above the Earth, they have to travel at 28,000 kilometers per hour, or 8 kilometers every second. These astronauts go around the Earth 16 times every 24 hours. Also keep in mind that the ISS is massive, much, much bigger and heavier than anything else humans have put into space. The United States' first space station, Skylab, that clocked in at 75 metric tons. Russia's biggest solo space station, Mir, almost twice as big as Skylab at 140 metric tons. The ISS, nearly 420 metric tons, three times bigger than Mir. So, how did it even get up there in the first place? Well, the simple answer is piece by piece and with a lot of cooperation. In the 1990s, the Cold War finally thawed out. The Soviet Union collapsed, and relations between Russia and the US were looking up. As it happened, the space agencies of both countries had been working on space stations of their own for some time, and neither of them could seem to get off the ground. Russia's Mir 2 had been in the works since the mid-70s, while the US program was slowly getting whittled away with budget cuts. The U.S. space station's name, by the way, was Space Station Freedom, which is the most 1980s American thing I've ever heard. Anyway, in 93, the two space agencies decided to take what they had and combine them into one station. The first piece to go up was the Russian-built segment Zarya, launched on November 20th, 1998. Zarya, by the way, is the Russian word for dawn, so hooray, symbolism! The first piece built by the US was carried up by the space shuttle 2 weeks later and was named Unity. Again, symbolism. Although, for me, the most symbolic part of all of this is the fact that the Russian rockets were originally conceived to carry nuclear weapons, but now they were carrying pieces of a space station that would be forever locked in a mechanical handshake with their former enemies. That and one of them carried a Pizza Hut logo. I'm serious, the next piece was delayed a few years, but when the Russian Zvezda service module finally launched, the rocket had a Pizza Hut logo slapped on the side. The publicity stunt reportedly cost Pizza Hut $1 million, which suited the Russians, who really needed the funding. If you're wondering why you've never seen a NASA launch that looked like a NASCAR driver's jumpsuit, well, they have a policy against it. But what's more a sign of the formerly communist East and capitalist West coming together than a 30-foot-tall Pizza Hut logo on a Russian rocket, I ask you? Anyway, once Zvezda connected to Zarya, the space station could function as a home for humanity in space continuously. And since November of 2000, that's exactly what it's done. Still, it had a lot of growing to do, and it did so in both directions, with Russian modules extending from Zarya, while modules from NASA, the European Space Agency, and the Japanese Aerospace Exploration Agency branched off of Unity. The Canadian Space Agency contributed a robotic arm that was used to help with assembly, as well as for grabbing spaceships and guiding them to the station. When this happens, by the way, it's called berthing, not docking, so a fun fact I learned researching this. The arm has the same grabber on each end, so it can walk end over end around the space station like the craziest slinky you ever saw. And while other agencies chose these symbolic names like Dawn and Unity, Canada called their arm Canadarm. You gotta love it. To give all these pressurized modules and robotic arms power, the station uses enormous solar panel arrays connected to a long truss. Today, the truss is connected to the Destiny module right by Unity, but over the course of the station's assembly, pieces of it had to be temporarily in other places. Really, the whole assembly process was like the most high-stakes game of musical chairs in history. This is where Shane Kimbrough comes in. Remember the NASA astronaut? I introduced him a while ago, but then I talked for a long time, and I'm sorry about that. But I needed you to appreciate his work. His first spaceflight was to the incomplete ISS in 2008, and he actually helped build the station.
That was a while ago when all that new equipment came up back then. And during that short mission, it was only about 10 days we were attached to the space station for that mission. So we really just delivered the equipment and hooked some of it up, but we didn't get the chance to utilize any of it. So on my last mission and on this mission, it's been great to actually be able to use those things, use the gem we brought up as well in other systems. So it's been really great to see the station grow and kind of mature over these last couple decades. And to be a small part of that is pretty cool.
The main workhorse that delivered the largest pieces to the station was NASA's space shuttle. It was so vital, its operational life actually had to be extended in order to finish the ISS. Finally, in 2011, the space station was complete. Well, complete, it's not really the right word, because it's still getting updated today. Which poses an interesting problem. Remember, the very first pieces launched in 1998, with some components dating back to the mid-80s. How do they make a Frankenstein monster of technologies from five different decades work together?
You would think we'd have the latest and greatest technology, but honestly, as robust as most of the equipment has to be and the testing process it has to go through, we're just by default not going to have the latest and greatest. But we have some really good stuff. Like, we just installed some new solar arrays on a couple of spacewalks Tamaya and I did that are really boosting the energy of the space station, and it will for years to come, which is pretty special to be part of that. We've just recently also upgraded some data and connectivity issues that we had. That's all kind of upgraded now. And a lot of that's not just for our personal use on computers, but it's so the space station and mission control teams around the world can send data back and forth and make sure that we're, you know, keeping the space station where we're supposed to be, in the right orbit and in the right attitude and orientation and those sort of things. So I would say we are relevant and we're current. We're not certainly the latest and greatest in technology, unfortunately, for us, but that's just the way it is. But we've been doing that for, again, many decades, and it's proven to be a great system.
By the time the ISS was finished, the price tag to launch and assemble all the pieces was a whopping $100 billion, making it the most expensive single object humanity has ever built. It's so expensive, Jeff Bezos could just barely afford to buy two. That's, of course, before factoring in the cost of running it, which for NASA is about $3 to $4 billion per year. And yet, I still don't think we appreciate this glorious hunk of space metal enough. Sure, it's huge, 420 metric tons, as I'm sure some of you remember, but it's all the way up there in space, 420 kilometers away, as I'm sure the same group of you also remember. It's hard to appreciate the gravitas of it when it's whizzing by so far away. So I asked Thomas Pesquet what it was like for him when he saw the fully assembled station for the first time in 2016 as he was approaching it to dock in the Soyuz spacecraft.
It felt like I was in a science fiction movie. It felt like Star Wars, when they get to the Death Star, like this huge, big, all those huge, big battleships that float in space. That's what it felt like, because the Soyuz is pretty tiny. It's 1.5 tons that come back to Earth, but still, you get to the station. I remember seeing the solar rays from the corner of my eyes, from the side window on the space station, and that seemed so far away. And then I could see the entire structure of the ISS. It really felt unreal. Like, it's a feat of engineering, like something so big. big, so complex, really actually does exist in space, and that shocked me, and it got real for the first time when I got this view on my first flight. That was unbelievable.
Which brings us nicely to today. Now that the station has been fully operational for over a decade, just what have they been doing up there? Is the station an expensive vanity project, or is there more to it than that? Come back for episode 2 when we talk about the ISS today, and I ask the astronauts the number 1, or maybe number 2, suggested question I got from social media. If you want to participate more in the show, you can follow us on Twitter and Instagram at Seeker, or you can follow me at Hug It Out in case I get to interview other exciting people, and frankly, I need your ideas for what to ask them. You can also let us know what topics you think we should cover on Seeker Plus. It can be anything. Fish brains, monsoon rains, orangutans. Let us know, and I'll seek you later. Seek you later was a fan-suggested sign-off as well, by the way, and it's great. I don't know why I didn't think of it earlier. Seek you later. It's so good. Okay,